Right. Good morning and welcome to this week's edition of NCompass Live. I am your host, Krista Burns, here at the Nebraska Library Commission. NCompass Live is the Commission's weekly online event. We're a webinar, a webcast, an online show, whatever you want to call us. We are here live every Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. Central Time. However, if you're unable to join us on Wednesday mornings, that's fine. We do record the show every week and it is posted onto our Encompass Live website. And so you can always watch out the recordings at your convenience. And I'll show you at the end of the show today where those where that website is and where those recordings are for you. We record the show. If there's any presentations or slides or documents or handouts that presenters include, we include that in our recording page. And any websites that are mentioned, I capture those and put them up on the Library Commission's Delicious account and have them all collected together for the recording afterwards. So you'll be able to catch up on everything we've done on there. Both the show and the recordings are free and open to anyone to watch. So if you are looking at some of the old shows, you want to watch something, go ahead. If you have any colleagues, friends, or colleagues you think might be interested in some of our topics, let them know about us. Share the information, share the links, and have them come and check it out. We do a mixture of things here. Interviews, presentations, book reviews, mini training sessions, demos, basically anything library related, we have it on the show. That's really our only criteria. If it's something related to libraries, something libraries can benefit from or use, or something that other libraries want to share, we have it on the show. We have a Nebraska Library Commission staff that sometimes do presentations, but we also bring in guest speakers sometimes, and that's what we have this morning. On the line with us is Beth Kabes. I pronounced that correctly, right? I didn't even ask.
It's
Beth.
actually Kabish, but that's okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. I should have asked. I try to remember lots of things to do to do the show, and sometimes I forget. But Beth is, well, I guess new title. She is the Director of Blended and Distance Learning for our ESU Coordinating Council here in Nebraska. And that's, you said just a couple days ago she had me update that info. And that is something new for you?
Right,
Or...
Krista. I've been working with ESU 7 for the last 12 years, and so
Right.
now I'll be transitioning completely over to the Coordinating Council. Yeah.
Nice. Now, is the council something new, or is that something that has been around for a while? I'm not sure.
The council has been around for a number of years. Boy, I can't remember how many for sure. Maybe 10-ish,
Okay.
maybe a little bit less, but yeah.
Okay. All right. And she's been working with this new project here going on in Nebraska, our Blended Learning Initiative. And she's going to tell us all about that. So I'll just hand over to you to explain it all.
Thank you so
Okay.
much, and good morning, everyone. On my first slide here, I am asking for some information from those of you that are present to answer just a quick survey. It's a Google survey, and you can access it through that go.gl/Z98 KS5. I do have two responses right now. Both responses are from K-12, and one of the persons that responded knows a little bit or has done some reading, and another one doesn't know much. And a third one has just responded that have tried and implemented some blended learning. So that's very exciting. So I'm anxious for you to go on to our to my survey and respond to that so I have an idea of where you are in terms of blended learning. Again, as Krista said, I'm the director of blended and distance learning for the Coordinating Council. So in our public schools, we have a ESU structure, an educational service unit structure, and that structure then supports our public schools across the state. We have 17 of those ESUs, and the Coordinating Council then helps to support all of the statewide projects, initiatives, things like that. So I am transitioning then to the Coordinating Council as this Director of Blended and Distance Learning. You can reach me at my email down there as well as Twitter. We do have a couple of Twitter handles with the council, and you should be able to access those by my Twitter. So, I wanted to know how many knew about blended learning, and we have about a little over 40% of us have no experience with blended learning, and only 20% of us have tried it. So because of that, I want to just go over a quick video. Actually, we'll be reviewing two videos, and they're just pretty short videos, but kind of give an overview of what blended learning is. So here's the first one. It's from Vimeo. And please let me know if you're not seeing it.
I'm on my computer a lot.
Email,
Google Docs, Google,
Snapchat. Technology has revolutionized our world. We can connect and learn and create and share. We have immediate, improved, and personalized access to the world. Nothing in our modern lives remains untouched by this powerful transformation, except for education. The big idea behind blended learning is combining online learning and brick-and-mortar schools with teachers, where students can learn at their own pace so that they can optimize their individual learning.
Combining the best of teacher instruction and computer-based instruction.
The world that we live in today isn't about paper and pencil, it's about computers. Having our kids become comfortable and familiar with that now is going to better prepare them for the world when they leave the school.
Blended learning can actually personalize for every student's individual needs to meet them where they are when they need it.
We are doing students and ourselves a great disservice to assume they all learn in the same way, but we need something new, and that's blended learning.
When you walk into a blended learning school, what you will see is small groups of students off with their computers working away on online learning programs, and another group of students in small groups doing rich interactive projects with each other and really collaborating as peers.
I'm able to now focus on smaller groups of kids, give them more individual attention, and help them with their individual learning styles.
Before, you're moving at the pace of the average of your 30 kids. Now you can really move at the pace of each individual student.
The teacher has the opportunity to look at data in the moment, in the minute, to know where our kids are immediately, informs instruction in the next period or the next morning.
In a regular classroom, it might take a week for you to get your test back. I can take a test twice in one class, get my feedback almost instantly, and figure out what I need to improve on.
Blended learning makes you in charge of your pathway, knowing how to navigate what you need and when you need it.
And that's true learning and knowledge. It's when you're able to apply content into real life.
All 50 million of America's students deserve the opportunity to have blended learning so that they can personalize their education and realize success in life.
50 million students in America.
50 million students in America.
So that video was produced with collaboration from Michael Horn. Michael Horn is one of the early researchers of blended learning. And Nebraska has looked to the Christensen Institute, which Michael Horn initially was part of that organization, to consider what we want to use as part of a definition for Nebraska. And similar to what you saw in the video, Nebraska's definition talks about combining online and face-to-face learning and giving those students opportunities for pace, path, time, and place. So one of the easiest ways to begin to think about a blended learning classroom is to consider a station rotation. And in station rotation, it's very similar to what maybe our elementary, our K-1-2 teachers have done with resource centers and those types of things. But using a station rotation, now we can look at meeting the needs of those students in these groups and allowing for students then to make some choice in some of their learning. So I've been able to document some excellent teachers across the state, and one of my favorites is this teacher from Seal Jones in Minden. And she is going to just show you how the students start, or how she starts with their station rotation. Now, this is the second semester, so the students have had a lot of experience with how to transition, what the expectations are when they move to those stations and so forth. So I want to give you just an actual view of what a station rotation and how that might look to begin with. Let's see if this one, this is a quick video. Okay. So what you may have seen there was the classroom moving from an all-group discussion to the stations, and the teacher was giving some instruction. So students were still over here in this area, were still working on textbook resources and maybe doing some drill and practice with some of the assignments that the classroom had been given. Over here in the floor area, those are students working on technology using IXL, so giving the students an opportunity to go beyond where they're at or perhaps go to a level that they're not confident in to solidify their learning. And then the teacher here is working one to few, it happens to be five, and she has grouped them based on the assessment that they completed the prior day. So these students either missed similar types of questions, and she's reviewing those questions with those students, or perhaps they answered all of the questions correctly, and now she's able to expand and deliver, go beyond what the initial mastery of that content is. So she is able to have the students in small groups. They know what their assignments are, they know what they should be doing, and they'll work in these small groups for about 10 to 15 minutes. It kind of depends on the student itself. So when we look at that station rotation, and you heard the initial video about blended learning, I'd like for you to go into a Padlet that I've created, and that is goo.gl/, and this is a lowercase is, capital I, 6X, and this is an L also. To me, sometimes it looks like a 1, but it's an L. So at Padlet, then we can begin to respond to what you think it might look like so that we can have some interaction in this webinar today. So if you will go to that link, that goo.gl, and I've just used a Padlet that I've used in the past so you see some examples of what others have shared about station rotation. So all you have to do is tap on the canvas, and it's kind of a sand canvas, and I will go to it here. So all you have to do is tap on it, and then double tap, actually. You can put in a title, what you think it might be, what you want to share with us of what it could look like in a station rotation model in your library or in your classroom, and then write what your response is. So again, if this is a title, I'll just put stations in library, and then I'll enter my information. So I would use small carts with plywood lids and have students group that way. So I would like for you to enter what you think it could look like in your library as a station rotation. And I'm going to go back to the link so that you can see the link down here. And again, this last letter is an L. So we have library learning has popped up. Very good. Oh, group on computers. Excellent. Okay. Group in small, with small groups, very good. I like that. So again, you know, what we could think of in the library is allowing for some station rotation perhaps during our library skills, or I think most of our libraries today, as I go and walk through the libraries within the schools that I visit, you know, you have small areas of either allowing students to work independently or perhaps giving some students to do some collaboration work, which I think is so important. So here we have another one, physical flexibility. Very good. I love that. So let's see what that is about. So I'll go ahead and add to that Padlet. It will stay open. So if you would come back to this and add to the Padlet later, that would be just supportive of the work that I do, and I would really appreciate it. So under that physical flexibility, we're looking for mobile furniture and tables to make those spaces, soft furniture, even couches. I love that. And those mobile furniture are so popular today, and I think that they really help in our blended learning spaces. So thank you for adding to that. And we have flexible seating coming through. Perfect. We'll see what flexible seating is. Yes, flexible seating is great for that. A Steel Case is a company that's making some furniture. And this person is trying this flexible seating in their classroom next week. How exciting. Would love to see some pictures. Tweet them out to me. And would love to see how that goes. So, excellent. You're doing a great job on that Padlet. And we'll try to come back to it in a little bit. So, to make sure that all of us have an opportunity to have your comments shared with the rest. So, again, what does this mean for our libraries? You know, we're talking about this flexibleness, and as I said, I do think that we've become flexible in a number of our resources throughout our library, our stations, and so forth. But what else does it mean for that school librarian or that public librarian to help support either the students or the classroom teachers? So, Mark Ray has an article from 2014 that talked about really supported this notion on blended learning and how we can support blended learning. And he has four things that he describes in his article where we can really look at this in our library. And the article, by the way, is Librarians Have Key Roles in Blended and Online Learning. It's from School Library Journal, and it's referenced in the bibliography of this slide deck, so you can access that a little bit later on. But anyway, Mark Ray talks about four ways that we as librarians have roles that we need to support our teachers, our stakeholders, our students. And those four items are curating those digital resources and helping those classroom teachers curate, collaborating with designing courses, online courses, or just designing the course to fit the online need or element of your blended experience, also to assist in implementing those strategies and those, any of the strategies or the structures of blended learning. And finally, to help guide those students in the areas of digital citizenship and effective online collaboration. So four key areas that, in my opinion, fit so well with what we're trying to accomplish in blended learning in Nebraska. So I really base a lot of this presentation on the work of Mark Ray. So in terms of curating that digital resources, I've included some examples. And again, if you get the slide deck off of the NCompass Live website, then you can access those links. But Symbaloo was one of my favorite tools to share those resources. It's easy to set up, it's easy to share, and it looks, you know, it's just fun to look at as well. So here's an example of a Symbaloo. So it's tiles. You can add different tiles to, this is called a mix or a web mix, and you can create multiple web mixes. You can change the colors of the tiles. So I have some classroom teachers that use, say, green for social studies and put in this corner red tiles, and those are for language arts. And over here, use blue tiles for math, whatever they want to do. But they're using this resource or this tool to curate sites for their students or their teachers to go to find those resources. So I think Symbaloo is easy to use, it looks great, and it's easy to share. So that's one of my favorites. Another one is LiveBinder. So I've created a couple of LiveBinders, and it's the free version of LibGuides. So if I were to have my choice, I probably would go with LibGuides, but LiveBinders is something similar. And what you do with LiveBinders is you have, it's kind of stacked resources or stacked pages. So it's a website that allows you to, so here's my introduction, and under there I have some goals, and I have a little video, I have an activity that I want the class to do, I have this, again, this video, and then have an opportunity to think about why, you know, put it all together. So under all of these stations, then I have something similar. I've asked to do an assessment. And again, this might look familiar. This is our Padlet. But anyway, I've set this LiveBinder so that it's kind of what I call stacked web pages and stacked instructions. So it gives the end user, either the student or the teacher, an opportunity to pick and choose what they want to do, or they can go sequentially as well. So that's just one way of looking at a LiveBinder. This is another one that I created that has the options on the side. So LiveBinder gives you an opportunity to add video, add links, add text, all of that type of thing. So I really do like that as a tool. Again, Symbaloo, LiveBinder, LibGuides is another one that works great. Lincoln Public Schools has an extensive LibGuide collection to help curate that their school librarians are curating for their classroom teachers. Others that I've read of, Storify, Scooped, PaperLI, your catalog. I have seen schools use their online catalog to help curate and list resources for their classroom and their students. Obviously Pinterest, and then any type of website that you might have. So one of the biggest things is that crazy internet is chock full of resources, and how do we know when we find something that it's meeting our needs? Does it meet our standards if we're looking at classroom standards? Is it educationally sound? Is it, you know, high quality? So us as librarians and school librarians, we need to look at and evaluate, you know, based on a rubric that we might have in our area, and then determine which one of these resources we should be sharing with our stakeholders, and then how do we easily share it? So it's curating those digital resources for our end users. The next thing that that Ray talked about was that designing courses and collaborating with those classroom or those stakeholders to design those courses. So I've included some of my favorites here. Lesson Pass is something that came out fairly recently, and I haven't used it with classroom teachers. I've just used it for myself to kind of take a look at how I could use it. But it's basically, you know, a course, and you're going through this course. It might be considered you might think of it as a MOOC or just an online course that you can learn from either as an individual or a teacher could set something up. Another one is using Coursera, and they have a number of resources and courses that you can start from, duplicate, or create your own. BlendSpace is one that I've seen a number of teachers go to. Again, BlendSpace is, I wanted to grab that that website. I didn't link it. But BlendSpace is, again, fairly simple, and you can go and grab a resource, or you can grab a lesson that's already been created and then basically duplicate that resource if they've created it using Creative Commons, and then you can edit it and add your own resources to it. So when I go into this library and I want to look for collaboration, then here is a BlendSpace that's been created, and 534 people have added it to their own BlendSpace resource. So it, again, is sequential, and you can add, as you see, videos. You can add websites. I guess I've never really added text. I've just gone through a Google document in order to add something if I wanted to do some text. But the thing about BlendSpace, again, you can go grab that, and then you can set it and edit it to make it your own. So I really like that BlendSpace when I'm trying to help teachers collaborate on some resources. And also your learning management system, such as Moodle and Canvas and Schoology and Blackboard, all those types of resources that might be within your area that a teacher is working on to design their course, then we want to be able to help them and collaborate with them, and this is where we can add or refine some of those digital resources for those teachers. So I think it's important to share with those stakeholders that a librarian, either a school librarian or in a public library, that we can help you find those online and print resources. All right. So we want to assist those teachers in blending that classroom. And this part is, to me, part of that PD part, part of that coaching piece, showing, you know, just observing any classroom teacher if they want someone to kind of come in and look at what they're doing to see if it may, you know, if it flowed. Maybe they have some concerns and they would like a librarian or another resource to look at. But this is where I think that our blended pilot is here to provide support for our classrooms, for our schools in Nebraska. So we have a pilot that is being supported by both the Coordinating Council and NCSA in Nebraska. NCSA in Nebraska is our Council of School Administrators. So we are working on this pilot together. We have 27 schools that are in this pilot for year number one. And what we were doing is meeting with teams from each of those schools and identifying strategies, looking at a vision for blended learning, developing what it would look like in their school. So if someone would walk through their classroom, do those look fors, you know, what would be something that either another teacher or administrator or a school librarian would want to look for in that blended learning classroom. Also giving those classroom teachers, which we're calling lighthouse classrooms, that support, that additional support. So is it curating the content? It could be. Is it collaborating with them to work on their online course? It certainly could do that too. So we've met with those teams already in March, and now in July we'll have another meeting, and those lighthouse teachers will be expected to begin blending their classrooms this fall. The thing about blending classrooms that you want to remember is to really start small, because it can be overwhelming. And if you're a traditional classroom teacher, or if you have a, you know, traditional setting, just making small steps can help you to be more successful instead of going just crazy whole hog and blending your whole entire day. So that's what we are suggesting, is that you start small, maybe take one class and a unit, and then build on that. Each year, then you build on it and you make adjustments, and it becomes easier and easier each year. But what we'll be doing is the ESUs will be providing high levels of support for those classroom teachers, those lighthouse teachers, so that they feel like they are have that success, or, you know, that foundation behind them. So it's a project that's going on with schools, with ESUs, and our NCSA statewide organization, as well as the Coordinating Council, are a part of that too. So we're very excited to be bringing this opportunity for these 27 school districts to go through this pilot. So the last part of what Mark Ray talked about was making sure to guide those students and give them support in that digital citizenship and effective online collaboration. So as school librarians and public librarians, we're always talking about copyright and making sure that we're evaluating those resources, and it's a high quality resource and it comes from a reputable site or author, but also that author gives us the rights to use that if that's how we, you know, if we want to use some of it or all of it. And so it's important to make sure to talk to our patrons, our students, our teachers, and share with them the importance of really looking at that digital citizenship and being good stewards of that internet. In addition to, how do we effectively collaborate online? So again, today we're talking about Padlet. I had you do the Google survey so that I can get a response. I can kind of judge where everyone is. And, you know, there are tremendous tools out there to utilize for any types of collaboration. This GoToWebinar is an excellent tool as well to get together either virtually or to share information with one another. So it's always exciting to think about that effective collaboration, but how do we do it in an online fashion? So in other words, can we bring in experts from outside of our state, outside of our community, and a virtual field trip, for instance? Can we do some of that to expand the walls of our classroom and work collaboratively with others across the nation and the world, for that fact? Part of the work that I do, I'm a member of a national organization, and that's exactly what we do. We meet on a regular basis using virtual tools, and we're talking about what we do in our organizations and how we can help and support each other. So most often in our library, we're doing similar tasks from the library down, you know, in Nebraska, down the highway, in the cities, in another library, in another community. And so how can we work together to really build our knowledge and our skills together and become even better libraries for our patrons and our students? So, again, as Mark Wright said, it's about providing that expert understanding of those resources and how to cite them and how to make sure that they're credible and accurate. So it's all about that relationship with the online collaboration and that digital citizenship. So, you know, how does this look in your library? In my pre-assessment, I had one response that says they provide background information, critical input with extensions such as apps such as Zaptions, and are planning to use Docent EDU. So very exciting to see what people are thinking about using in your library. So what I want to do now is another interactive activity, and I want you to include your thoughts about what activities can you be supporting or are you supporting to improve or increase these blended opportunities. So here is another GOO. It's to a Google Doc that is open, and you shouldn't have to log in order to access that. So this is lowercase r, l, 1, f, 4, and then uppercase a. So again, R, L, 1, F, 4, A. And in that Google Doc, I've included cells or a table. And I want you to basically talk about what you would see, you know, what are you doing? Oops, sorry. What are you doing in your class, in your library? What would you like to do in your library? What have you seen, perhaps? And all you have to do is select a cell, and in that cell you click inside there and just describe those activities that you could do in your library to support or to increase those blended opportunities. So we did the Padlet, which is similar, and again, the Padlet, what does it look like? Here I want to know what is it that you're doing or what is it that you may plan to do, or what would you like to do? So you can just select a cell. Again, if you wanted to include your name or your email, that's optional. That would be fine. It looks like the font size is pretty big. I'm going to very good. Thank you. Awesome. I'm going to try to go in and change the font size to a little bit smaller, so it isn't so big. But anyway, I want to make this a little interactive, and again, I'll go back to my presentation so that you see the goo.gl. And it's RL1F4 and a capital A. So looking for what do you think you could do to work in your library, or what is it that you're doing in your library that could support these blended opportunities. So we have one person that's using Symbaloo, and they've already used Symbaloo. Awesome. Nice. So excited to hear that. Enter as many things that you want in that Google Doc so that we can have some interaction between all of us and support each other.
Beth, I do have a question. When you were talking about collecting the from the different sites that have the different pre-made lessons or things that you can pull from, you know, somebody else has created something and you can use it and then modify it, some sort of a activity or whatever. Something that popped into my head was something like Khan Academy. I wonder if it would that have you looked into that, or if that would be something that would work with this as well. They have free, you know, training and videos and lessons, basically, on all sorts of different sources, on all sorts of different topics?
Yes, they do. And Khan Academy is a great resource.
I'm not sure how much you can modify it, because I know you're talking about you've always got to modify it for what you're doing in your classroom.
Right. The Khan Academy videos, and that's what Saul Khan is known for, is some of his video work. Mm-hmm. It started out with math, and now he's expanded it to, I believe, some science. And it's wonderful tools for those learners to go through and repeat and review again multiple times some of those methods or how to, you know, like for instance in math, how to do types of equations. Mm-hmm. I have received feedback from students, and I think it's great content, and I'm not trying to cut it up, but I have received feedback from students that when a teacher uses a video from, say, a Khan Academy or something else, the students are not as engaged, and mm-hmm. what the students are saying is that they have their teacher, and they know their teacher. So if they want to learn something on a video, they want to learn it from their teacher.
That makes sense, yeah. I know Khan Academy is more, I think the way it's been more promoted is independent learning. You want to learn something yourself because you needed maybe a tutorial or something on it, or you just said, I want to learn more about math or engineering or whatever, just for my own, you know, reference. I just didn't know how well it would go along with this. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah,
that is exactly right. Exactly right. And again, some teachers might use that, but then they might incorporate some of their own mm-hmm. resource, you know, video or audio also. Yeah. So
makes sense.
Exactly. And teachers don't like to video themselves, but you know what? You really, really need to. Because to me, the important part is when I'm working face-to-face with students and I'm getting ready to introduce a really important piece, students can see the excitement both in maybe my hand gestures or in my face, like my eyes might get really big. And if you don't provide that opportunity for the students when you're teaching some content, then they lose some of that. So I think that's really important. And anyway, we talked about that a little bit from this video or this webinar, and I kind of decided that because I was introducing some of that video, I didn't want to really push out I wasn't recording it ahead of time because this is live. I didn't want to push the bandwidth so that we would have so our videos wouldn't work too well. So anyway,
right.
Oh, you guys are doing a great job. We've got LibGuides people are using, and look forward to exploring Blend Space, and that's from Kelly at Beveridge Middle. Very good. They have some funding and would like to change out some furniture. Barb Hart is talking about Google Classroom and tools for students. Excellent, Barb. Love it. So, very good. We've got some people that are responding. It looks like Mandy said amen. thank you all for sharing some of the things that you're doing in your schools or in your libraries. I do appreciate your interacting with me today. So, suggestions, and this really goes with some of what Krista was saying, building those online tutorials. Screencast-O-Matic works well. You can have it follow your mouse, but I personally like the Show Me. Is there a question?
No, we just lost the audio for a couple of seconds right when you started talking about Screencast-O-Matic, but now you're back.
Okay. All right. I really like Show Me and I lost it. But Show Me works really well. It's on the iPad. It's a whiteboard. And I've seen it with those classroom teachers that are in a rotation, and it's the teacher with the students, and the students are all using Show Me. Maybe they're doing a math problem, and so the students are creating the math problem on the Show Me, and then they can save it, and they can go back and watch it again. It's work that the students made. EduCreations is the other one that I like as well. And both of those that you can record, so you can even use that to record your lesson. One classroom teacher that I talked about to this spring, I asked her, how long are your videos that you share with your students when they're looking at, you know, when you want them to do maybe a flipped classroom or they're going through some video? And she said 2 minutes is what her, and she works with middle school. So 2 minutes is the length of the video that she puts together for students to watch. And then I asked her, well, how many minutes does it take you to record that 2 minutes? And she says, it takes me 2 minutes to record the video. And she says the reason why is because even if she has a flub, she has a flub when she's lecturing in front of her students also. And so she just takes that as part of the experience and adds that to the video. So she doesn't go in and clean anything up to make it perfect. It is what it is. She says, now sometimes I will start all over if I get into it and I'm not feeling good about what how it started. But she says that her videos are short and she doesn't go in and edit them.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be perfect. It actually makes it more relatable. I think the student, like you said, the students want to see their teacher and they want to see him not being all prim and I did this exactly right and I recorded it 10 times to get it right.
Precisely, that's exactly right. So, okay, well, I wanted to share one more site that I think is helpful if you're trying to work with classroom teachers that are confused. What does it look like? How can it work in my classroom? This Better Lesson, betterlesson.com is a great resource. It has videos. It has examples of lessons. I'm going to go and show you one of them that I pulled up. Oops. So this is a classroom, tour of a classroom, and we'll just watch it real quick. It's a little over a minute.
Can you turn the volume up on this one? It's a little quiet.
Okay.
So we call this altar. Oops, up all the way.
Yep, I have the volume all the way. I can't. Sorry.
The beach is more kind of a non-traditional environment where they can lounge. Most of the time, beach chairs are not in the same spot, so they move around quite often. And over across from the presentation area and the beach, which is, I guess, the presentation area is the shelter, we have the jungle. And this is more of a traditional environment, except for that there are these tractor chairs. So I picked these tractor chairs specifically so that students wouldn't have a back and they'd have to stay engaged while they were learning. And then this is more traditional with back chairs. And most of the time, these roll around in this area. And then lastly, is what we call the lookout, and I have two stools that sit there, and those are just for students that like to sit more high top and look outside.
So again, this Better Lesson has, and you can search through it for example lessons. Also, I was looking at time and space. You can, here are the sections here. So if you're looking for routines and procedures, because that's really important when you're starting out, here's some examples. So routines and procedures, here's carpet transition. it will give you, in most cases, it will give you a video, but also will give you some document that you can also support with your classroom. So you can take that document, you can edit it, and share it with your students or use it as part of your lesson plan. So Better Lesson is a great resource in order to share with classroom or other stakeholders or even students that are questioning what it looks like, how can I implement that, you know, so it gives you some concrete resources to use as that support person in our schools and libraries. So that pretty much takes me through my presentation today. I wanted to go back to my Padlet and see if we had any other resources, but these are some additional pieces that I think are worth reviewing or reading. And again, this all can be found on the slide deck for today. I also included a bibliography of those of that article from Mark Ray, as well as some other resources that I used to prepare for this presentation. But again, let's go back to our Padlet. So, master teaching skills, very good. Hitting all the levels and nuances of each learner, awesome, from the lowest to highest. I love that. That's great. Let's see, I think we had flexible seating. Great, I'm trying this in their classroom, excited to get something like this. So that video that we showed you might be something that you could use. I think we had some of these before. Students would not become bored during class or used to multitasking, and this would allow them and to know that they will not do one skill the entire class time. Very good. So again, you can go back to that Padlet at any time if you want to add to that. That would be awesome. I'd love it. And we'll come right back to here. Okay, I think Barb had added some things that critical input works well with Zaption and Docent EDU. Very good, and she's had students create Zaption projects too. So thank you, Barb, for sharing. So are there any questions to ask? I know, Krista, we've had some interaction. Are there questions from others?
Yeah. Does anybody have any questions? It looks you can use your GoToWebinar interface, type in the questions section, or if you have a microphone, just say, I have a mic, unmute me. We'd love to get your voice on the show, too. It looks like some of you guys are already doing this and using this in your classrooms, which is great. Obviously, this isn't something being done just here in Nebraska. Beth, you had said, while we're waiting to see if anybody does have any questions, I believe you. This is a pilot project we're doing here. You said it started in March, or I missed it.
Right, we had a kickoff in March, so okay. We brought all the teams together in March, and we worked with the Highlander Institute, mm-hmm. which is an organization that, is working with blended learning specifically. So, is kind of experts in the field, you could say. Mm-hmm. And then we'll bring them back in July, and we'll do some additional training and planning for their rollout this fall.
Okay, so it hasn't actually been put into practice in the classrooms yet? You're just working with the teachers? Or I know you said you suggest they start small.
Right. So we do have pockets of teachers that are blending their classrooms. I think Barb was talking about that. Mm-hmm. Some others. So, and now we're trying to make it more of a, and I would call it a systemic effort. So mm-hmm. these schools that are coming together for this pilot, we're looking for some, like I said, these lighthouse classrooms. And then the year two, how can we scale that to include mm-hmm. more classrooms and just continuing to build on that for until they can have some kind of systemic implementation of blended learning in that district. And the reason why is because you have a third grade classroom that's blending their class, and now all of a sudden they go to fourth grade, and that fourth grade teacher is traditionally teaching the content, and the students are, really wanting a more personalized learning experience. So we need to be able to build and scale so that every student has that opportunity.
Yeah, and that's one thing I was wondering about. How has the reception been from, so far in Nebraska, from the educators, the teachers? Are these lighthouse schools the ones, are the lighthouse classrooms, did they volunteer as, like, I'm one of your more forward-thinking early adopters type, or were they just selected?
Mm-hmm. I think it's mostly that they have volunteered and are that type that are willing to jump into something that sounds mm-hmm. that like it would be good for the kids. Mm-hmm. We do have a couple schools that said, no, I want you to do this because it works great with your content and you have the resources or whatever. So for the most part, though, it's teachers that see the benefit. We've had some trainings across the state, and we've had these teachers come to those trainings and go back to their school and implement, and they just are, the results that they're seeing is so exciting to see. And then I talk to their principals, and the principals are equally excited because now they see students that previously have not been engaged in the learning, and because they can kind of direct, you know, not entirely, but they can make some choice and they can work together, they can work separate, you know, giving those students some of those opportunities to learn in the style or the fashion that best suits them is powerful. And those principals now are seeing that, oh my gosh, you know, we have been really not allowing that student to grow how, you know, he or she prefers, and we've been keeping a lid on them. And so now that we give them those opportunities, we see so much more growth, and the students are becoming more engaged, not only because of the technology, but because of, you know, these types of strategies that we've been talking about.
Mm-hmm. That's one of the things that just jumped out at me about this whole thing is so many, in every classroom, there's so many different levels of ability. And
exactly
just how some are ahead of this of what everyone else is doing, some are behind, some just learn differently, and it's really hard, as I think, as a teacher, to how do I help all of them and get them all moving along in this particular curriculum, what we're doing, and just standing up there and lecturing doesn't cut it anymore. No.
No, it doesn't. That's exactly right.
I'm glad that we're realizing that, because that kind of thing, I remember when I was in school and all the way up through college, bored me. I suffered through it and tried to, you know, keep myself awake by taking notes and doing things, but it is just not the most. Yeah,
exactly. So and our students today, our children today, our learners today, they're not the type, for the most part, not all of them are able to learn well and at the rate that we want by a traditional lecture class. Mm-hmm. There are still students that learn well like that. But for the most part, our students are not geared that way, or their brains aren't working like that.
Mm-hmm. And it's nice to mix it up, you know, and no matter which way people are, if they're good at one way of learning, but still mix it up in the classroom during the day, and maybe they'll learn some new thing that they didn't realize they connected with.
Right.
Well, it doesn't look like any questions came in. I think everybody was great using those Padlet and those other things you're using to interact. I think that's awesome. Just someone did have to go. They said, nice, you have to get going. Nice job, Beth. Thanks. Just some thanks on there. So before we do wrap it up, does anybody have any last minute urgent things you want to ask Beth? You know, you can reach out to her. You've got her email or Twitter, the websites and everything out there. I do have the link to her presentation that's going to be included in the show afterwards. It does have within it all the different websites and things she did. But also, I have captured I'm going to show my – there she is.
Hey. Okay, good, yeah.
I have captured in our Delicious account the links – that were mentioned, and the videos. So I know some people are having trouble hearing a couple of videos, just the sound was slow. That's not a problem. You'll be able to watch them yourself if you did want to. I know the one of the second one, there wasn't a lot of audio in that one anyways, guys. It was just the little teacher doing a bit of an introduction to tell the students where to go, which you explained afterwards anyways. And then then it was just silence while they moved around the classroom. So didn't really miss much, yeah. Then I think, since I don't see anything urgent, we'll wrap it up for today. I'm going to pull back control to my screen. I can click on the right button here. Da-da-da. There we go. Let's see here. All right. There we go. Yeah, here's her presentation, as I said, that we had before. And over here, as I said, in our Delicious account, that is running slow today. There we go. Where I grabbed some of them. Here's that last video. So you'll have a direct link to that one if you weren't able to hear the sound on that. All this will be included in our recording. Over here on our NCompass Live website, what's great about NCompass Live is if you're trying to find our site, you don't know the link, that's fine. Just Google NCompass Live. And apparently nobody's called anything else this yet. We're lucky. We are the only thing that comes up when you search for NCompass Live. So get to our website here, and our archive will be right here underneath our upcoming shows is the archives that we have of all of our previous shows. And this does go back all the way to the beginning of the show, which was in 2009. So everything is here. If you want to watch it, they're on YouTube for the videos. The presentations may be on our SlideShare account or in Google or Prezi or wherever the presenter had it. And then all the links in Delicious. Yes, some of the information on the older ones might end up being old, but we are librarians, we're archivists, everything's there for historical purposes. This is our last week's show, and this one will be set up the same way, a lengthy recording on YouTube. The presentation, this one was to SlideShare, this I would link it to your Google one, and then all the links will be here, so all in one place you'll be able to have access to all of the recording from today. So thank you very much, Beth, that was great. I'm glad that I saw this session. It was in our NLA conference this past year. The Nebraska Library Association and School Library Association annual conference was it in October last year? Yeah. Mm-hmm. She had presented this, and I wanted to bring it on the show because I thought it was really, really cool information what they're doing. And also since now that the pilot started, yeah.
Right.
Maybe in a year or so I'll have you come back and give an update on how things went and how things are continuing.
Mm-hmm. That would be exciting. I'd love to do that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And thank you for attending.
I was going to say, my last picture on my last slide is from that conference at NLA.
I thought I recognized some of the decor.
Right.
From here, yeah. So thanks. I hope you join us, everyone, next week when our topic is the librarian as candidate, activating activists for funding, and election day outcomes. I didn't create this title, but I had to try and say it correctly. John Kratzka, who's from Every Library, is going to talk to us about being able to advocate for your library and working. They work this. Every Library is a group that a nonprofit that works with libraries across the country when there's votes coming up and trying to get things, information out to the people in our government on how to support libraries. And he also worked here in Nebraska just earlier this year about our LB 969, and he'll explain all of that when he comes on the show next week. So please do sign up for that show next week, register, and any of our upcoming stuff. We got Google Books, Vermont Libraries, Jessamine West will be with us later in June, and then Libraries Without Borders. Always new topics coming up here, so keep an eye on our schedule. Also, if you are a big Facebook user, NCompass Live is on Facebook, so pop over there. There we go. And like our page, I do post notices about, here's a reminder, log in today for today's show on the fly, when our reminder of an upcoming shows and when our recordings are available, I post it on here as well. So if you're big on Facebook and want to just get notified about what we're doing, like us over there. Other than that, that wraps it up for today. Thank you very much, and we'll see you next time on NCompass Live. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.